same, so our, the problems could be jellyfish somewhere, could be anchovy in the Black Sea and so on. We have to know what is the problem you are trying to deal with, what are the historical variabilities you have looked at, what is the pressure from land in terms of deforestation, nutrient runoffs, how the population may be growing and putting pressure on resources, or how the demographics is changing in terms of their income level. So in India and China, for example, the consumption of meat is going up very rapidly. This has very specific impact on how the land is raised and how agricultural land gets converted to something else, and so on and so on. And you have to also have an objective. You have to know who your users are, what they're asking for, what is the time scale at which they want the information, and so on. But in this case, you had basically the biggest demand was to have some kind of a interactive decision-making tool on how the land use affects the Chesapeake Bay. And I'll show you an example of what kind of prototype was tried. Okay. Are there any questions? These are very general points. So you have to have a very good idea of what the users want. You cannot just keep producing model output and putting it on the website and think that people will come and use it. This has been tried for 30 years and it just doesn't work. So you have to talk to the users, know what they want. In our case, they have red tides, brown tides, and so on, fish kills. They have jellyfish problems, they're rich people living with boats, and they want to know if they can jump into the water or not. There are human pathogens here, like microcystis, which can cause serious liver damage. Your dog, if you throw a stick into the water and tell it to fetch it, the dog can actually end up dying if it has rained a couple of days. It gets very toxic. There is dead zones that the farmers would like to know about insect infestation, health information is asked for, and of course the government is asking for how sea level rise is going to affect this area, because Washington DC is sitting right there. The president worries very much about it. So, and you have to worry about the scales at which this information is needed. When they say they want air quality information for asthma, that is not at the same scale as a farmer asking for water resource information. They're two very different spatial scales, they're two very different time scales. You have to know that. So whatever model you are taking, you're running, you have to have this kind of thing in your head. So the atmosphere is done at a certain scale, land is done at a certain scale, the water body is done at a certain scale. And the information you provide, it depends on whether the aviation is using it, whether the sailors are using it, whether water resource managers are using it. They all want different time delivery. The recreational sailors want to know by Thursday whether this Saturday it will be good to sail or not. Whereas a water manager will not want to know within 3 weeks if he will have enough water in the reservoir or not. You are having very different demands, and the skills they require is also very different. Recreational sailor will just say, is it going to be too bad or is it sail? Whereas this guy wants much more, the water resource manager will want much more precise information. So you have to have a full range of knowledge of that aviation people want and very precise information about winds and microbursts and so on. That's just the seasonal stuff. And doing the land, when you do fisheries, often you think that's the most difficult thing you are dealing with until you start doing hydrology. Literally at meter scales, you need to know what types of soil you have, what kind of tillage practice is being used, how much water withdrawal is having, how much leaching happens from the soil, what kind of fertilizers they use, what kind of crops they are growing, when they are planted, when they are harvested, and how much water gets into the, how much nutrients get into the soil. And that's what determines how your fishery is being affected. And the regulations being made here are often related to either having good soil organic quality or having regulations on water quality. It turns out that what is good for soil organic quality is not necessarily good for water quality. So these models should be able to tell them, if you do this, then water quality will get worse. To optimize everything. And people who sit up here in Pennsylvania and New York are being told that they shouldn't use too much fertilizer because the bay is getting polluted. That guy is never going to see the bay in his life. This is just like how we are polluting the global ocean. Somewhere we are throwing the plastic and it's ending up in the stomach of an albatross or choking a turtle somewhere else. So how do we deal with these situations when you are so far away? Even the simple network approaches may not work in this case. So you have to have a strategy of using information that actually is convincing that if you change here something, you won't suffer and yet you will benefit somebody else. That's where you have to reach the cooperative nature of the human mind and get beyond just making money or doing what's right for you, avoiding the local tragedy of the commons and so on. So this is mostly what we've been looking for, looking at adding MPCD to a ocean model, adding plants, oysters, sharks, etc. So we have to worry about what's forcing our system and how climate change is affecting and human behavior is affecting what comes into these water bodies, how they're getting purified, and so on and so on. So it's a real earth system, it's a very complicated system, and we have to be aware of that. And these are the kind of things that everybody's using now, jellyfish, ontological group called Calatinium beneficum. So this is very specific. Alexandria, for example, which grows in the Gulf of Maine on the Puget Sound, prefers cleaner water. So if you use some regulation for agricultural control and clean the water quality here, but it gets warm because of global warming, it's possible that you will get rid of Calatinium, but Alexandria. You have to know whether what you are doing is really good for everything, or do you care what it means for the future, whether you will have another interest or another interest to get stronger and so on. You have to really collect as much information as possible and make sure that your model has some sense. It doesn't have to resolve everything. It has to have some sense of how it may relate to other things that you think are unrelated. But everything gets related in unexpected ways. And how do you put confidence in your forecast? We haven't done that. And seriously, very few groups are doing actual forecasts for fisheries using the kinds of models that are being described here. Maybe Patrick Leody is doing a little bit somewhere here. You think you forecast your
fish? Yes. The road
to the So we have a long way to go in terms of making actual forecasts with the physical models, forcing the fish models, learning how to propagate the uncertainties and biases of the physical model into our fish model. And the typical way you think of it is if you're, let's say you made a yield forecast of tuna, they were off by 10%. You shouldn't jump to think your tuna model is wrong, because if there's 30% error in the physics that's forcing it, in all likelihood it's the physics that's wrong. This is essentially what came out of some Marty's work, showing that when you improve the physics, all the models got better. So you have to be really sure where the error is coming from. And after that, you have to find a way in which you put confidence limits on your forecast. This is what was developed by us for ontological group forecast, where you look at things like IT skill score, which is a way of saying whether your forecast is basically saying climatology, worse than climatology, or better than climatology. If you say it could be just climatology, then your model doesn't get any credit. That's like reading the farmer's outline. Then you have probability of false detection, probability of detection, and so on. You can combine them to optimize and say, when my model is here, I'm 60% sure that there is going to be a harmful algorithm. And this kind of information is really being asked for now, because a park manager who's managing a beach wants to know by Thursday or Wednesday whether this beach will be, he can keep the beach open or not. Because if he comes to office on Saturday morning and tells the people on the beach that beach is too contaminated, people get upset. They drove a long way or they maybe flew in and so on. So with this kind of method, you can do that. And if you remember the instrumentation we're talking about, people are trying to develop handheld bacterial sensors, like DNA sensor, which you put in the water and say, you can see if our forecast is right or not. And you can have a digital library of all the pathogens in the water. And you can just check what is in the water. So this is kind of the way future will go. We have to develop kind of a confidence limit for our own forecasts. Okay. And as I said, now there is more and more demand for kind of interactive user tools. And there are many versions of this where some fisheries people are taking game theories and adding multiple players and agents and looking at resources. And I think you will do some role playing tomorrow where you will approach on some of these ideas. But essentially, the model is resolving a few things, at some time scale, some spatial resolution for some region, and people want to change certain things. They want to see if an increased population density or increased greenhouse gases, a changed land use, what will happen to the Chesapeake Bay in this case. And you can, they want this kind of information for everything, for tuna in the West Pacific or that zone of Oregon and so on and so forth. So the next slide shows you an example of how they're trying to do it. Don't take it seriously, but that's kind of what you have to think about. Users want to play themselves and figure out what might happen, what they are dealing with. So maybe, hopefully the sound works.
Planting of corn will significantly change the state of the way. Let us undo the changes to the map and consider the